course, I forgot to record earlier. Oh, Lordy. Anyway, it's hard to get good help.
So, okay. So Doug, I was trying to figure out the significance. Is the bull solid gold? So it's going to take a lot of those hundreds to buy it?
Yeah. Well, I call it the golden idol. Capitalist golden idol is what I called it.
Oh, there you go.
The bull, it's actually, it's a miniature of the bull that's on Wall Street. You may have seen it. It's kind of a famous famous statue.
But we're in a bear market right now, are we not? Maybe not for $100 US bills. Oh, I don't know. Okay. We better keep moving here.
Thank you.
Now, is Robert with us?
He is not. He sent me a message saying that he is on the ferry right now.
He's on the ferry. Oh. He has moved, yeah. Believe it or not. The time came. Yeah.
Yeah. So I have a couple images from Robert. This one is titled On the Edge.
Yeah.
So quite literal there. Like it.
Like he's going to walk the plank. Yeah.
But there's no plank to walk.
There's no plank. Well, that's the problem with planks.
Okay. And then this one is going gone. So
yeah.
And that's what we got there from Robert.
I think he will, once he settles, he'll probably zoom in the fall occasionally. I hope so. Yeah. I encouraged him to do so. Most popular model of the evening. Christine, are you there? We're not hearing you. Still hoping to hear Christine's voice. And it is a good shot. I don't see all the images, yes. Christine.
You're muted, Christine.
I know. I'm here.
Good. Good. We were going to send out a search party on a motorbike.
Yeah. Yeah, I was submitted my latest photos of the photo shoot at TRU. And this one I had liked in color too, and I just had turned it to gray scale, and I liked the effect of it as well. So like the bokeh background and reflection of the trees in the mirror and the expression on the model lens face. And I got some serious looks, and a smile here. And this is one of the other models, Adam. And I like his expression. I have some of the softer smile. I just like the way the black and white. I did a lot of these in black and white this time again. It worked well. There was a bit of red on the cement that would have worked too, I guess, in a different way, but I was trying to remove that. And just like the soft expression. And then model Brick, this is when the wind was helpful. I was hoping for the wind to just kind of blow her hair just the right way. she had lots of the flowers on her jacket were a nice color too, but
well, that's real nice. Again, if I were going to do it all again, I would be much more directive with the models, and I would look at different poses. And at one time I had her look back over her left shoulder, and that was quite nice, but I realized that this sort of thing is great. And, you know, the hair just dropped straight down, which had a particular effect, but that touch of wind just livens it up so nicely. So yeah, well done. Yeah.
Thank you. And I think I just had one more of again, with a different look with the hat. Closer shot, and that's all for me.
Yeah, you have a very imaginative approach. Yeah, well done.
Thanks.
All right, can everybody hear me?
We can.
Excellent. All right, so kind of what I was going for with my pictures was, I think about four of them are receding subjects, I would call it, where I'm trying to get the bit of it closest to me, sharper, but the distant part, I'm okay with being a bit blurry. And in all of these, part or all of my subject is clear, but the background is a bit blurry. But one thing I kind of like to do with photographs sometimes, if I can, is if I have a bunch of similar objects in a cluster together, I like to frame them so that they look like they're kind of endless. You can't tell where they start and stop. And that's what I was going for with this photograph. I was up at Home Depot with my sister-in-law because she was buying some flowers for the garden. And while she was wandering through the flowers and garden section, I was looking at the shopping carts going, oh, those would be great subjects, and taking pictures and getting the occasional curious look from people around me. So my subject is kind of the sign on the cart, the Home Depot part, but more the caution part. And then you can kind of see it on other carts, but it's a little bit blurry. I also liked the sea of orange it created. So next one. This is in my favorite stomping grounds up at the cemetery on Notre Dame. I like to go up there periodically to find interesting objects that people have left in the graveyard. A lot of them on graves, but sometimes if there is, like in this case, if there's a tree near a grave, people will leave little signs and ornaments that to honor their loved one. So I'm assuming this one had some significance to a grave nearby, but I don't know. I also kind of angled my shot so that nice blur behind the tree, you can kind of see the headstones if you know that's what they are, but I wanted it to be more of a blurry wash of green, and had to angle it so I didn't get one of the nearby headstones or whatever to kind of break the green up. Next one. I have an interesting old piece of vintage embroidery that I bought at a thrift store for $1. So part of my project with my Flickr account is not just to document my projects, but to document interesting stitchery and stitching related items that I find. And so I took some good overall pictures of my beautiful peacock embroidery, but I thought it would be interesting to angle a shot so that I looked up at the tail so that the bit of a satin stitching that's closest to us is clearer, but that the tail kind of recedes away. So again, it's kind of an endless sea of embroidery that if you didn't know what it was, would look kind of abstract. You can't tell quite as well because the file is reduced, but the part where the bolt or nail is in that handle is my crisp part of the photograph, and the handle over to the other side is the blurry bit. You can also see that I tried to get the paint around that handle end in focus too, because I really like how it peeled. I like how you can see the wood underneath, and I like how another layer of paint under the white, the sort of reddy color, kind of goes with the rust on the handle. This is on an old shed or garage that's in an alleyway in the downtown. And it looks very vintage, and I thought it was a really nice flare to the end of that handle. And next one. These are some awesome flowers that I have found on a walk. somewhere around in Kamloops. I don't remember where. And I also angled my photo. So again, one side of it is crisper and clearer, and then the other side kind of recedes into blur because it gets further away from you. Next one. This one I wasn't quite as happy with because I wanted a bit more blur in the background, but despite playing with the settings, I couldn't quite achieve it, though I tried. This is on the walk down into Peterson Creek, where you start at Putzahalli Secondary, the path that they made a few years ago. This is walking down through it, and so you can see the path in the distance, but I wanted to make this really evocative sign the subject of it. And I think that's it.
Thank you.
Thanks for sharing that.
Hello.
Hello.
Oh, sorry, just a minute. Hold on.
We're holding.
I dropped the mouse.
Okay. You didn't drop your coffee on your keyboard.
Nope. Just this, the mouse went over the edge.
Okay. There we are.
This is of course you know what it is. It was one of the flowers at Chase Meadows.
Oh yeah.
The Scona Meadows when Therese and I went to take flower pictures. I just like the swirly shapes and stuff in the background.
Yep.
Okay. Next. Again, same thing. I just like how this one sort of looks like a painting, almost. So, what can I say? Next. And a Johnny Jump Up or a Yellow Bell. And reading the book on the flowers, it says they start out being yellow and they turn redder as they get older. So these are two elderly Johnny Jump Ups. Next. And you know what this is? It's the Western Tanager at, I took it at Mac Island last week. Mm-hmm. I got lucky. It was I was doing continuous shots sometimes, and it was just in the left of the photo, and I cropped it, and I thought, oh, I really like that. It turned out the eye is clear. So, next. And this is at the Butterfly Gardens at Mac Island, but if somebody can help me, I'm not sure what kind of a bird it is. Is it a flycatcher? I'm not sure. Who knows birds?
Isabel or Dave, any thoughts on the species?
I suspect it's a, could it be a Pacific slope flycatcher? Or it's one of those horrible little Empidomax flycatchers that are so hard to tell apart.
I tried to look it up in the book, and I've got the white circle around the eye.
Well, actually, it's not a ring, though. The eye is critical there. It's that white on that partial ring.
Oh, okay.
My books are handy here. I'll get out some bird books, but carry on.
Okay, next. Is there a next? Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Okay, this was last week in my front yard after it had rained in the morning before the wind came up. And I took a couple of shots of the leaves of the iris. And I had three that I really liked, and I chose this one. Yeah.
I'm going to put it back.
That is fantastic.
I liked it. Okay. I think that's it. Yeah.
Thank you. And I'm sorry I couldn't come with you to the meadow that day. I had other plans, otherwise I would love to have come up with you. But thanks for the invitation.
It was a lovely day. Yeah.
Is Angelina with us tonight? That's Angelina's backyard, isn't it?
Hello. Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Yes. So I've been away. We went traveling and we went down to Southern Nevada and Arizona. And I took this over the edge as literally being at the edge, kind of like Harve. And this is a place called Cathedral Gorge. And it's in Nevada. And these sandstone formations are not really quite as big as they look. If you look on the right hand side or the left side, there's a railing there, but they're extremely interesting. So, next. And this is another gorge in the place, which is too bad. I should have a photo of it, but I forgot to look at it. But anyway, this is a railway bridge we're looking at, and I'm standing on an old road bridge. And it's very deep. It's a couple hundred feet deep. So the next photo, I think, is looking down from that bridge underneath it. Next. That's a close-up of that bridge. And they built this bridge by hand, apparently. They were in a big rush to get this railway bridge done. And there was some photos of the guys hanging underneath it, building it. And there was some smashed cars at the bottom underneath. And it's very interesting. Next. So we went to...
Sorry, it just cut out. Are you still there, Angelina?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, my internet just got weird, so...
My internet's weird too, because I'm getting a sign on my computer says, your internet connection is unstable.
Okay, I got the same thing.
Okay. I think it's mine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Am I okay to move to the next one?
Yes.
Yes, you are.
This was at Bryce Canyon. And the day before we got here, it was about over 100 degrees. It was probably 40 degrees. And then we drive 300 kilometers over to Bryce Canyon, which is up a lot in elevation. And our plan was to get up in the morning and go hiking for sunrise. And we got up and there was a blizzard. It was snowing like crazy. There's no way we could hike. So we slept in, went back to sleep. And this is when we got up and went hiking. The snow was just starting to clear at about 9 o'clock in the morning. And it ended up being quite a nice day, but you can see the snow flying over the edge there. Next. Oh, that's it. Oh, I just want to say one really funny thing. I forgot to submit this photo I had of a frog, but it was a frog and my camera fell over the edge into the water. My V850 Nikon fell into the water and I lifted it up as fast as I could. Water was pouring out of it. It was completely soaked. I turned it on for a second and it just sort of all the symbols that it can show showed. So I turned it off. I took it apart. I took it home. I put it in the sun and then I put it in front of a fan overnight. I put it in the sun the next day and it's fine.
Wow. It
worked. There's nothing wrong with it. So... don't let your camera fall in the water.
You were lucky. I had a D90 way back in the day and rain got into it and it fried the motherboard. So, yeah.
Oh, really? Well, I guess it's a well-built camera because, it's okay.
Well, that's why pros use it. Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My turn.
There we are.
So yeah, dandelions. I spent most of the winter just waiting for the dandelions to bloom so I could get some pictures of them this year, and decided that this would be a perfect opportunity. So went out in my yard, got down on my belly, and I like how you can kind of see the blurry dandelions in the background too. Yep. I like dandelions.
They're beautiful. They're much maligned. Yeah.
Yes, they are. And this is Oscar, Chris's cat Oscar. And he was just seconds before I took this picture, he was melting over the edge of his little cat toy there. And then he lifted his head up, and this is the picture that was better. So yeah, he was.
I just like to point out with his eye, it's actually a really good shot because he's got his iris is fused to his cornea, like he's got a deformation. So to actually get a picture of his eye like that is, it's hard. Yeah.
And this is our hen and chicks plant in the garden. And this is just a tiny little piece of it, but this one little baby one there was just creeping over the edge and trying to get out. And I just thought it looked so cute and it needed to have its picture taken. So this is one of my goats who is grazing on the edge of the bank. She is not supposed to be out there. I was actually out taking pictures of something else, and she snuck out to see what I was doing. And just the angle that I was able to get her at, I just thought this was a really kind of cool picture. Yeah, this is Nutmeg, right, grazing out on the edge of the river.
Great name.
And this is the one I took last fall, I think, of just some of the grasses. This is actually along the railway track along where I have my goats, just looking up into the morning sun. And I was playing around with trying to get a bit of a sunburst flare there. Thought this one turned out kind of cool. And another goat grazing on the edge. This one was allowed to be out here, but this is our little baby Rain. Fun. Goats are fun to take pictures of. And that's it for me.
Thank you.
And that is it for our last showcase.
So what do you think, Crystal, about showcase throughout the year?
What do you mean, what do I think? Well, I love it.
Yeah. Do you think we're better photographers as a result of it?
I you know, that's up to everyone else. I'm going by what everyone else has commented on the themes and how they found a bit of a challenge, but they accepted the challenge and they were grateful for the challenge. So I think my goal from the beginning to now, I think it was a success because I wanted to not just challenge, but I wanted it to be accessible for everyone. Like I didn't want to pick. It was a rough year, like, right? And at the beginning, not knowing where we could go, we could travel, we could, you know, a lot of people were just comfortable staying home. So I wanted to pick something everyone could shoot, but at the same time, make it, open it up to a bit of a challenge. And yeah, if you want to accept the challenge or interpretations are amazing too. I loved every showcase. I think it was a really good year.
Yeah, I think you gave us a challenge, but it was a challenge which was achievable. And what I remember, say 2 years ago, we were all just raiding our archives, just finding something that we thought would be okay. This time we had specific things to go and do and to experiment with, and almost without exception, the images were created for the showcase in the weeks leading up to it. So I think that's a huge plus. Certainly I challenged me more, and I think I submitted for all of them. I can't quite remember, but anyway, well done everyone. So every once in a while, one of our members comes up with an image which attracts attention. And of course, you know, Norm Dugan often figures very well in national competitions. Something in me thinks he might want to pitch internationally, but I won't say out of the blue, but Bonnie Price shared an image in a showcase some time ago, and she told us a little bit about the story of it. And I'm just going to find out where it is. Several people, it's been shared a number of ways online on Facebook. And also Brian sent around the notice saying that this image had been chosen by Kappa to be submitted for an international competition called what? The Four Nations? No, the Four Countries. What is it?
Four Nations.
Four Nations, yeah. So I think we're submitting, is it 20 images to this?
I think there's 80 from each country, New Zealand, Australia, and South Africa, each submitting 80 images, each from, all 80 images are from a different photographer. Yep. So there's no doubling up there. And I'm not sure what the timeline is, Ken, on the competition, or I'm not even thinking, I haven't thought about the competition and won't, because I was just thrilled to be chosen.
Yep.
So it's pretty exciting.
So in conversations with people this past week, several people have said to me, how much was done in camera and how much was done in post-production? So that's a question I've invited Bonnie to talk about, and just give us the story of this image, if you would. Thank you, Bonnie.
This was taken
Before we go any further, I'm not sure where the kid noise is. Crystal, is that on your end? Whoever has the kids in the background, if we could mute, that would be great. Thank you very much. Okay, Bonnie.
This image was taken last September at Abraham Lake, which is partway up the Icefields Parkway. And there's a large lake that you see people doing pictures of the ice bubbles in the winter. And this is actually at the end of the lake. It's not part of the lake. It's where the river floods. It's a dam controlled lake by Rocky Mountain House. Mm. And so it floods, and all these birch trees are sitting in the water, and they look particularly beautiful in the fall when their leaves are, when their leaves turn yellow and orange. So we were there, and most of this was done in camera. It's a long exposure, and it's although it's only 8 seconds long, I checked my settings so I could share that with you. It's only 8 seconds long, but it's a long exposure to blur the water. We were fortunate to be there on a day that wasn't too windy, because Abraham Lake it's a narrow valley, David Thompson country. It's quite windy up there. And so it took an 8 second exposure to blur the water. And I'm just fortunate it wasn't a windy day, because then the leaves would all be blurry. So it would have been tough to combine two images with a short exposure for the leaves and a long exposure for the water, because there's just so much going on this image. I edited this solely in Lightroom. And I basically, what I did was, what I do, my workflow is that I usually set my black point and my white point, and I dropped the blues a little bit, and then I went into the color balance. Let me just pull this up on my Lightroom. I went into the hue saturation and luminance, and I just pushed the blues and the aquas up a little bit as far as saturation. A little bit of luminance, and then saturation, a bit of saturation in the leaves to make them just a little bit more gold. The image was a little bit washed out compared to this. So I did pump it up as far as color goes, but the water is really a beautiful blue to begin with. And I cropped it so that I could cut out, there was some sort of stray trees. And I did a little bit of dodging and burning, dodged the trees to kind of brighten them up a little bit, increase the white point in the trees with selective brush tool. And that's pretty much it. I wasn't sure if I'd taken it into Photoshop, but in fact I didn't. And I took a few stray leaves out with the erase tool, but that's pretty much all I did. So in order to take this picture, we had to put on dry suits, and we were actually walking in the water, and I was up past my chest in the water, hoping upon hoping I wasn't going to step into a hole. And I had my tripod, of course, as well, because it was a long exposure, and gently feeling my way along the bottom of the lake. And there was lots of opportunity for different compositions, and but this was the one that turned out the best. So,
and did you take a lot of images? Would you have taken 20 images?
Oh no, I probably took 60.
60. Okay.
Yeah, I would have taken 60, but all different compositions. Some in a portrait orientation, and this just worked.
And did you go wanting to capture this particular sort of image, or did you happen upon it? You did. Okay. I
mean, to be honest, I'm not the first person who's shot this kind of an image up there. Paul Ziska, I think, was the first person who kind of discovered it. He lives in Banff, and he spends a lot of time up at Abraham Lake, particularly in the winter. And he had shot this image, and so a lot of people have followed him up there to kind of explore that, because it's so unique. It really is unique. And the camping up there, I mean, you're right in the Rockies, so it's a very beautiful area too, but I did have this in mind that I was going to do that. And so my husband convinced me. I said, oh no, we'll just be able to go in the water. And he said, no, I think we should take dry suits. And we happened to have dry suits because we raft, and it was I wouldn't have bought this shot without.
Could I ask you something, Bonnie?
Mm-hmm.
How did you get, you had a low exposure for the water, but how did you get the trees still really sharp in the foreground?
Well, the trees weren't moving. So it was a long exposure of eight seconds, which isn't that long an exposure, but it was enough to blur the water. So I was just double checking, you know, to see when I took different lengths of exposures to see what kind of the minimum was where I get a really nice blur on the water. And so of course, because I was on a tripod and I put the 2 second timer on. So probably if you zoom this picture in, you'll see a little bit of motion in the leaves because it wasn't absolutely dead still. But of course the trunks will be still because they're still. So if you come in, see the,
That's awesome. Yeah.
But I ran it through. I like using Topaz Lab sharpening tool, and it does a really, really great job. And so I did a bit of selective sharpening kind of over the leaves, and it helped a bit because I think they were a little bit blurrier. But I think what makes this image too is the reflection of the tree trunks in the water. If it was just solid blue, I don't think it would be nearly as interesting an image.
Yeah, I just thought the blur with the water, and it goes right back, that the trunks would be blurred too, but no, they're not.
No, not because they're standing still.
Yeah.
The trunks are dead still. So I could take a minute long exposure and they're not moving, and the water would be even more blurry. But in that situation, if I'd done that, the leaves would for sure show up blurry. Yeah. So I was looking for the minimum length of exposure to get a blur, but not blur the leaves. So it was a bit of a tricky situation.
Yeah, no, it's beautiful.
Being up to your chest in water with a tripod must have been a little scary.
Yeah.
Well, to be honest, what I did was I left my camera on the bank and I walked around with my tripod because there were lots of holes. So I'd step into a hole and go and kind of mark the spot in my mind. And then I set my tripod up in a spot that I wanted. And then I went back and got my camera, carefully kind of walking where I knew there weren't any holes. Because you could have gone down. I could have gone down in a second accidentally stepping into a hole. That would have been just very messy and very sad.
Yeah, no kidding.
Apparently Angelina does that on a regular basis. So, you know, you should just try throwing it in the tank and see what happens.
Well, I've gone through the ice before, but.
Yeah.
But I was just looking at the pictures from that trip, the rest of the pictures. And, you know, I had some with leaves in the water, and because there was just a little bit of a ripple, the leaves in the front look blurry. So that was a picture that didn't exactly work, but there was just so many opportunities. You can just walk around the south end of the lake for, we were there for several days and it was quite stunning.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Yeah, it's a stunning image, so well done. Final question, moving out a little bit further here. I mean, what are you hoping to do with your photography? To some extent, is there anywhere to move now for you personally, professionally?
That's a million-dollar question, Ken. Mm. When I retired as a physio, I had no intention of being a working photographer. Mm-hmm. And I've been scouting for the Film Commission. I've been doing work for a few different agencies. And I've gotten a little bit away from my creative photography, which doesn't make me particularly happy. But I think the bottom line is I just am interested in doing this for pleasure and spending time outdoors and being creative. That's kind of my goal.